Welcome to People. I'm Shirley Lin. Today I'm in Tienmu, and this is a very special place. It's a restaurant. It's called Lili Bar&Lounge. But the important thing is that I'm here to interview and to talk with Patrick Lee, who is an artist as well as the owner of this restaurant. And first of all, his arts are very unique. As you can see, the one behind me, it's the leader of China, Mao Zedong. And this is the leader of Taiwan. Well, they are former leaders, okay? And this former leader, Chiang Kai-shek. And look what he's got in his hand. And first of all, he's got his arm around him. They're great buddies, and this is rare, okay? This is unusual for this to be happening. But anyway, they're sharing the beer together. So this art is called Time for a Drink. But let's go and talk to Patrick. All right, this is the Patrick I'm talking about. Hello, Patrick.
Hello, Shirley.
It's so good to have you here. And well, actually, I'm really glad to be here at the restaurant. And then look at your art.
You are most welcome. So, I'm also very excited. You know, so you come over here to introduce my restaurant and my artwork.
Yes. So this one right behind us, it's amazing. All right, it's the former Chinese leader Mao Zedong.
Correct.
But what's unusual about him is that he's wearing a pair of Converse. Well, actually, it's one big Converse shoe.
Eventually, Converse, yeah. A long time ago when I was a child, those days that's a sneaker with a red star named Zhongguoqiang, Strong China. And literally, it's turned into Converse. Of course, there must be some story behind that. We don't know. Of course, now the owner of that sneaker is an American company called Converse.
Right.
Oh,
of course, there's a connection with China because there's the red star on the emblem, the trademark.
Right.
Oh, so how did you think about having Mao Zedong wear Converse?
Well, actually, have something to do with, my childhood memory, because those days, I had a pair of Converse.
Oh, you actually did?
Eventually, those days, the pair of a sneaker named Strong China, Zhongguoqiang.
Yeah.
Therefore, my childhood memory and the current situation, scenario of China, Taiwan, and let me, think about, put them together. So that have some historical and contemporary meaning. Of Taiwan and China, right.
Well, it's amazing how you found a photo of him, that profile in the wicker chair and just perfect.
Eventually, it's that picture, of Mao Zedong on a wicker chair is very popular. Many artists use that, but in a different way. I'm the one more naughty, put
naughty.
Him in wearing a pair of oversized sneaker, right?
Oh, wow, that is really cool. Well, we should go on to the next one.
Sure, let's do it.
Yeah, let's talk about that one. Well, we actually saw a similar one to this at the front door. Yes, and this is actually another original, but of the same idea. So here's again, there's Mao, and then there's,
Chiang
Kai-shek.
Right.
But of Mao itself, that's also a pretty popular original one.
Correct.
And then of Chiang Kai-shek himself is also a pretty original one. So obviously, this hand and this hand, it wasn't there before. So talk about it.
The hand of the god.
The god's here.
Okay. Yeah, this eventually is this arm is the arm of one of my chef, right?
He's famous now.
Yeah. And this also his arm holding the beer bottle.
Right.
So, of course, the image of both of them was taken from historical, the photo. Then, of course, we moved that around to, put them
together, you know, make a party for them.
Mm. Right. A party. Right. Yes, a beer party.
Right. you know, having Taiwan beer.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's Chiang Kai-shek, like, you know, naturally he loved Taiwan beer.
Right. And he would introduce it to
Mao.
Right. Exactly. So actually, this whole thing was silkscreen.
Correct.
Right. But the hand part was painted.
Right. You right. can. You know, eventually it's now. It's also silkscreen.
Oh.
Right. But it's just transplanted from, you know, my chef's arm because
right.
There's none of this image exist. Right. So, I have to make it happen.
Yeah. Right. That's right. That's right. This is really cool. So here's Taiwan beer,
right.
Share with Mao.
Right.
And obviously you had to ask permission for the photos, right?
Yeah, I did call them, you know,
you call
I call
them
Mao Zedong, I give him a ring, you know, no answer. I call Chiang Kai-shek and he was thrilled, very exciting. Then he helped me to find Mao Zedong. Then they have a consensus, both of them agree, this painting should make it happen.
Right.
And also this painting represents a scenario of cross-strait political relationships. Right.
That's right.
Right.
And actually, Chiang Kai-shek told you, make sure that you have him holding a Taiwan beer.
Yeah, that's the only insist of his. And Mao is whatever, so long as they can have a party and he agreed to anything.
All right.
Right. Okay.
Well, there's an upstairs to your restaurant.
Yeah, that's,
so let's
go. Take a look.
Now.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, Patrick, now
yes.
that I've got a tour of your restaurant and all the drawings, the paintings, rather. I want to get to know more about you, though. I mean, you know, you've had quite a life to start off with. And in fact, I think most of our listeners don't know yet, you're actually a self-taught artist. Now, you grew up knowing that you really like art. Are your parents artistic? This is a question I always ask people.
My parents, they are farmers.
Oh.
They were farmer, anyhow.
So,
they were peasants, so
okay.
Everything is just, you know, maybe they have that artistic gene, and maybe I inherit that, right?
Right,
But anyhow, I just love to, you know, do drawing, painting, yeah.
So I know that, I think you grew up kind of not very well off because you actually even like went to school with no shoes on your feet. So what did you use to draw as drawing when you were small?
You know, so we draw on
anything
on the dirt, right?
On the dirt?
On the
wow.
dirt, on the ground, right? On the
yeah.
dirt, right? Because when we were kids, you know, there were, you know, the yard and which is to dry the grain, dry the rice, right? The grain, the crop. So we draw on that. Then literally draw on board, right? Go to school with charcoal, draw on the board, blackboard, then
so
draw on paper.
So you were using chalk this whole time? I mean, what kind of
things
were you using?
No, that's the chalk, not
yeah,
yeah,
but
chalk.
I mean, like at home, I mean, you
no, at home, nothing.
Chalk, nothing.
You know, when we were kids.
Not even pencils?
You know, at my age, those days, in my era, you know, Taiwan was so poor, right? During the 40s, 50s, that was really poor.
Mm.
Right. So not even easy to, you know, for our parents to feed our brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
Right? So the art supply, don't dream about that. And we didn't even know what is art, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I know, that's true.
Right.
So it's amazing that you actually grew up with this interest in art. How many brothers and sisters do you have?
Oh, I got totally eight, including me, right?
Yeah, eight.
So it's five boys, three boys, including me, and
five girls.
Girls, right.
And while your parents were busy in the field, you and your brothers and sisters kind of find ways to entertain yourself, right?
Right.
But you also help out in the fields.
Yeah, sure, we help. And we have to, you know, help, you know, say the crop or having to help, you know, the, remove the wheat in the rice paddies, right?
See.
Right, or, you know, the feed the dog, feed the chicken, feed the hog.
Yeah.
The pig, the zoo.
Yes, right. Pigs. Yeah. Wow. Of course, I mean.
Then we go to school without sneaker.
No shoes.
Because cannot afford sneaker. Not until I was the third grade. Finally, I have one pair of sneaker that was a star on that, right?
Yes.
Called that time, red star that time called 中国奖. But it's so precious. So we tie the string and carry that on our shoulder, go to school still barefooted. And after a few months, feel, you know, that I got to wear that, then my feet grow bigger than the shoes. So painful. Then, you know, literally the shoes, you know, the front of the shoes, the toe come out, the back, you know, the butt, you know, my feet, you know, touch the floor, right?
Really?
Really sure.
You try to squeeze your big feet
into the unfitted Converse, the unfitted 中国墙 those days, right?
Yes. You said it's strong. What? China
中国墙, China strong.
Strong
China, right?
What a name. But I gathered you were a good student because you actually managed to go and study at Zhenzi University.
Correct, right.
Which is one of the prestigious universities in Taiwan.
Right.
And you were studying...
Accounting. Right.
Now that's useful. But then eventually, after you graduated, do you think you really put that into good use, accounting?
Eventually, I never, have a job that is accounting related, but the accounting itself does help me, to realize and to manage business in a more efficient way.
Okay.
Because I will be more figure or, sensitive, right?
Mm. You are a very adventuresome guy because, you kind of try different businesses. You're one who loves taking risks and trying different things. And you actually, from accounting major, you got into fishery business.
Yeah, before fishery, I was in fishing business. I was the one of the major fishing importing house in New York. I was their manager, in Taiwan, managed their Taiwan office.
Yes.
Literally managed their office, across Asia, from Korea all the way to Singapore to Thailand, right? But after a few years, I found out, that's too easy.
Too easy.
I tried to find something that's
something
not many
exciting.
People never heard of, so I get into marine seafood business.
Okay.
Right. But so from there, of course, it's about start from the Falkland War period of time. So those days I went
ago.
To, South America, to Argentina, or Chile quite often, right? Then anyhow, get into seafood business. And literally, the fishing fleet owner, came to me that they have a cage of a salmon in North High Sea of Northern Pacific Ocean. Therefore, and come to me, ask me to help them on the marketing. There, so I did. Then from there, I get caught, in political, confliction for, between USA and Asian countries, especially Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan, for high sea, benefit of between countries.
Okay.
So I was set up by Uncle Sam. Then I spent more than 5 years in the States, in the pen.
Yeah.
I mean, in the pen, in a prison, right?
5 years.
And of course, 1 month after, they set me up, and Taiwan surrendered and give up our high sea sovereignty on Northern Pacific, you know, on fishing to Uncle Sam, right? And South Korea also, 1 month after Taiwan, South Korea also did the same. Of course, Japan would never give up. That's, they were right, it's their right. But Taiwan and South Korea, we need our Uncle Sam so as to make us, you know, sleep better during the evening those days, because we need their protection, we need their weapon supply, we need their anyhow. But instead of it's life, you know, different people have different life, right? And anyhow, it's just my life experience.
Yes, well, it was unfortunate, but then how
yeah, anyhow, you lose, you win some, you lose some. You lose some, you win some.
How
you lose some, you learn some.
Yes,
right?
Yes, agree.
Right.
So how were those 5 years?
Those five years, you know, I had to say, of course, I made some friends. They are mafia, you know, they are drug lord.
Oh, I'm
right?
sorry.
Right? So I pick up my tennis skill when I was in prison days,
wow,
right?
Good.
The drug lord from a Colombian drug lord called, Andre Pulido, as now I remember his name, a good looking guy, such a gentleman. When you're looking at him, you wouldn't know he's a drug lord, right? He's the one teach me how to play tennis. Right.
Really?
Right. Andre Pulido, now I remember.
Okay.
I wonder how he is now. Right.
All right. Yeah. Now, you got out of prison and everything. How did you get into art?
I always, since I was a kid, I always doing.
Oh, I meant like, how did you decide that for the rest of your life, your focus was going to be art, and then you thought, this is it.
Anyhow.
I'm going to do painting for the rest of my life.
Anyhow, after I get out of the prison from States, I was deported, right? Of course, you know, Taiwan is home, they don't have to deport me, because I was set up and I paid my ticket, flew over there and you know, step into their trap, right? Get caught. But after I came back, they deport me. Then I think, you know, I was not in a drug, I was not doing anything, you know, right? I was just buy and sell fish, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like, you know, buy and sell salmon, right? So why, or rice, but why I deserve that? So anyhow, maybe, you know, I have to blame on my previous life. But anyhow, I decide not to spend, you know, my life, you know, on those big business. So therefore I opened a bar, small bar or
so
restaurant, and I
low profile.
Right, low profile, and do my painting, and the space, the wall of the bar or the restaurant will be my gallery to show my work, right? And of course at the same time I acting as advisor to the big consortium, right? And in Taiwan, you know, at the early days, I was advisor to Core Pacific Group. Like, you know, Jinhuacheng is one of their subsidiaries.
Yes.
And my good friend, or the big boss of Core Pacific Group, is Shen Qingjing Xiao Shen, right? The Jinhuacheng, right? Or Weijing Jitian, the Core Pacific Group.
Yes.
Then also, literally, you know, I work. And I'm still is acting as a business advisor to Joseph Garner, the facade group in the whole world. They design and install the best, the most sophisticated facade, such as Taipei 101, such as Jingmao Building in Shanghai, such as Morris Tower in Shanghai, such as early days, like you know, the opera house of Sydney, or like in, you know, a museum of Mercedes-Benz in Stuttgart of Germany, like, you know, many substantial one in Hong Kong, those high-rise building, Bank of China in Hong Kong or whatever.
Well,
many
I see
of them.
That. Yeah.
Right.
I see that you know, you do cover a whole variety of different kind of art, I mean themes, like actually you have a collection here in your book, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
this? Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. This is the Guan Yin.
This one is Sijiamoni.
Sijiamoni. Okay.
Buddha, anyhow. Sijiamoni.
Right. Yeah. Right. See, so not just Mao or Jiang. Mm-hmm.
Jiang Kai-shek,
but there's also of the Buddhas, you know, like Buddhism, and you also have female profiles,
nude, right?
In nude.
Right.
Do you know where?
Let me try to find
it. You've got some really, and then of course, oh, the red ones. That's it. And then of course, landscapes.
Mm-hmm.
And here we go.
Yeah.
These two,
you can.
Nice red background and calligraphy, beautiful calligraphy, and also a nude, female nude.
Right, and this, right?
Yes. Yeah. So, and then there's landscapes.
Mm-hmm.
How did you decide on these themes? Well, actually, it's just.
Anyhow, so those women, whether they are, those nude, whether they are Chinese or Westerner, I have no idea. But the background, you know, you see the writing, the calligraphy, that's Chinese.
Yeah.
So it's a blend of West and East, Chinese and West, right?
Western East,
right.
Okay.
Right.
But interestingly though, you're saying that about 90% of collectors of your artworks are from abroad.
Right.
Why is that? This is really, really interesting.
I think it's basically the art training between the Westerner and we Chinese or Taiwanese, there is a big gap, right? Historically, you know, the Westerner, they are more sensitive to art and beauty. So it's really you walk into someone's office or their house, on the wall, there is no art. Everyone have painting, either a good one or a bad one, either a print or a genuine, right?
Mm-hmm.
But in Chinese, most of the family or in the office, you see bare wall, or wall with some very goofy kind of a display or hang up there, which don't work together with the surrounding.
Right? Yes.
So I would say maybe Westerners are more sensitive and they love art which are Chinese but also Western related. Right? So, you can see the element of my art are Chinese, but the way I express that is more in a Western skills or Western method.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I think they love it because of that.
Okay.
So it's really have a piece of art from, because in Chinese, in Taiwan, most of them, they love my brushwork, right? But the Westerner, they not only like my brushwork, but my other work, you know, they especially love it. You know, it's difficult for me. You want to call it pop art or
pop
whatever.
Art.
I have no idea. You know, the art is art. So pop, it's difficult for me to give them a definition or to categorize them.
Mm, pop art, that's a combination of Western
or political art
or
art, you know, with Buddha head or Guan Yin, but nothing is religion related, but of course, there is a Buddha head, right?
Mm. Yeah, I think Western people, they really like to decorate their homes so that it welcomes, when they welcome their friends, to make it a very comfortable place for friends, a cozy place for friends.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you're right, Western people, they almost always, their homes, they almost always have some kind of Eastern or Asian kind of, I don't know, indication or decoration to their homes.
Right.
Yeah, I think it's their curiosity about the East?
I think so. We should be proud that Chinese, right? Taiwan also part of, you know, the forget about politics. Taiwan also Chinese, right? We are also Chinese. But anyhow, so we don't really cherish our 5,000 years of culture or history. But Westerners, they are very much curious about what is the Chinese culture, right? They always feel we are more profound in culture. So in that case, they respect art or anything that's Chinese related. And I'm luckily, you know, my work is Chinese related, either in culture or in politics or in lifestyle. Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, you know, it's interesting that you seriously got into art in the 90s. Mm-hmm. But then it wasn't until 2002 that you actually had formal solo exhibition.
Yeah, huh?
Like, you know, in Taiwan. But then but then the next one was like over in Denmark.
Yes.
You know, it's interesting that you made yourself known outside of Taiwan. Mm-hmm, and actually you're probably more well-known outside of Taiwan than...
Correct. Correct. If you ask someone in Taiwan in the art, you know, the field, I think 999 out of 1,000, they wouldn't know who is Patrick Lee, right?
But how did you make friends with all these foreigners? How did they get to know you from way out there?
You know, it's word of mouth, right?
Really? That's
and
it?
Nowadays, you know, the IT is so popular, so handy. So it's not
Facebook,
surprised.
Huh?
And Facebook or, you know, the email, whatever.
I
right?
see.
Right? So and word of mouth. And so often, you know, I got a inquiry from Berlin, from London, from New York, from Singapore, from Hawaii, from Tokyo.
They,
I need this, I need that. Do you have that? Or can I do something, you know, the similar or whatever?
So all these people are asking you for exhibits in their country, right?
Right.
So the list never ends. So your schedule must be really full. Where's your next exhibit going to be?
Going to be here at Lili. Now I have an exhibition
goodness.
In now I have an exhibition in Geneva, right? And in
you just had it
Lyon.
Or Geneva.
Yeah, you know the one French lady. She managed that, and I have to find out how she is going now. But the one in Geneva, he sent me a few images, and one in Lyon, he sent me a few images. I didn't go because I don't have time to go. I still need my time to spend in my studio to, you know, do some more work, right.
So they love your work.
Uh-huh.
Why? Did they ever tell you why they love your work?
Yeah, you are asking me a question that's, which, you know, I wouldn't have an answer if I... No, then I will be even more successful, right? So well, I don't know.
I know, Patrick. It's right. All because you got your name on it. Patrick Lee. Yeah, anything
is it?
That's got your name, Patrick Lee, on it.
Yeah, huh?
They want it.
Mm-hmm.
So you have some faithful collectors of your artwork.
Uh-huh.
And lately, you've been, just only a couple of days ago, I think, you came with landscapes where it's just the sun that's in gold and red. And then the white mountains, because it's all covered in snow. And then a black cliff. I love that piece, by the way.
Okay.
You told me it's already sold.
Right. So I could try to do something similar, right? Because the brushwork, no second piece is 100% exactly. Could be.
What was the name of that one?
Oh, the black one?
Yes. Did you have a name for it?
No, it's none of my work. None
that
of my work
untitled.
Have a name, right?
And if it's
all
untitled,
of my work doesn't have a title.
So if it's untitled,
right.
It's even more precious.
Right. Anyhow, that's you said. I hope so. Right.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Patrick. It's been a lot of fun learning, getting to know you, and appreciating your art. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, honey. Say thank you, honey. Say thank you,
bye-bye.
Honey. Say thank you. Honey, don't bug. Oh, okay. Bug also one way to say thank you, right?
Okay. Well, thank you for watching, people. I'm Shirley Lin.
Thank you. Bye.